Next keynote speaker, Professor Poon Nai, probably needs no introduction. She is the most famous labor sociologist in Hong Kong, and I would say all over in Greater China, or even in the world, from what I understand. But for those who are coming from other parts of the world, okay, you should know that Professor Poon Nai is a sociologist, okay, from the University of Hong Kong. And she was actually the first Asian scholar who ever won the C. Wright Mills Award, okay, very important for the study of social problems, for her award-winning book about migrant workers in China, which was not only widely read, okay, in the academics, but actually inspired, okay, playwrights, artists, okay, and, of different kinds. You know, so, and to this audience, particularly important, I want to emphasize that Professor Poon Nai is a scholar activist. Right? She has been involved in many campaigns. She has helped to start labor NGOs, and she has been very deep in the labor movement, okay, in this region. Okay. And her talk, okay, is about reimagining the Chinese Revolution, okay, and rethinking, and the platform, okay, is the slides coming up? Okay, so the... No, there's no password. Okay. All right, so I need to talk longer. All right. So I think her talk actually, in a way, in a nice way, very, very much continues what Michelle talked about, right? We need a global, okay, commons, okay? But also, some of you probably want to ask the question, why we left New York is such a great city, okay? I still want to ask Trevor, maybe Trevor can tell us. But then my reasoning is because, okay, when we talk about social movements, you know, when social movements are animals that grow in different contexts. Okay, so the New York has its own fantastic ecology, but here in Hong Kong, in China, okay, in Asia, we have our own ecology. Okay, that Michelle already mentioned. All right, so there are major differences from continent to continent, from country to country, from different places. So what Professor Poon Nai will be sharing is going to be about the historical context, okay? How should we think about, okay, the labor movement, okay, in the context of Hong Kong and Greater China, where we have also social economy and the long roots of social revolution. So with this, okay. let's welcome Professor Poon Nai.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks a lot. It's really an honor to be here. When Jack Chiu invites me, I'm not quite sure whether I'm really the right person to speak here, because I really haven't been working on this issue for a number of years. But when I really get involved in the co-op issue, when I really get involved in the social economic issue, actually I was working closely with Terence Yuan. So we together tried to document a number of cases, not only in Hong Kong, but also in China. And we compiled three volumes. So we publish it in Hong Kong, in China, and one volume is internationally. But then, because of this experience, so I tried to organize an international conference like this one in Peking University in Beijing. And I was immediately received a lot of attack. So that's why I stopped almost all those practice until Jay asked me to do it again. So it is really so thank you. It's really a time for me to refresh my experience and also try to rethink, those issues when I tried to organize a conference like this in Beijing. I was immediately, challenged. So I will let you know why. And then also because of this challenge, let me to reword the presentation today, because I really try to adjust to them. And also when Jet invited me, I was thinking that audience is Asian audience, but here it's really international. So I'm not quite sure today my presentation is really relevant to you because I would like to address to those problems raised by the Chinese, but especially the Mandarin Chinese when I was doing this kind of thing in Beijing. Okay, so let's begin with today's presentation. So I was trying to, I try to understand platform co-op because I'm not really a technology person, not at all. So I can just simply understand platform co-op as a kind of social economy or as a kind of community economy. So it's one of those practices. So it's within that platform, within that framework, I give my talk today. And then, so if I understand correctly, I mean, when we talk about social economy, when we talk about community economy, obviously it's all about common. And obviously we would like to talk about paradigm shift, not only in theory, but also in practice, covering economic, social, and cultural development. And we would like to look for alternative model, to challenge the existing neoliberal economic models. And obviously, we also have more specific goals, like to reconnect economy with community development, to supplement free trade with fair trade, and also to replace huge monopoly cooperation and company with social enterprises, co-op, and collectives. And we also like to create, common form, or I'm not that scared to use the word communist, after so many years in China. So to create communist form of production and poverty that can uphold integrated principle of development, equality, and environmental protection. So, in many occasions, every time I talk about social economy or community economy or co-op, I would try to emphasize it has to be a social movement or it has to be a social revolution if we only have any kind of chance to get succeed. So I understand that we need a social movement simply because we really need to create a new platform or new network for social or community economies that can take core principles, those three, three ecology, economy, and equity. And that's all about economic democracy. So it's apart from political democracy, we talk about economic democracy. And we need really to develop a new model of work and life that can create long-term impact on revolutionizing the idea of money, economy, technology, community, power, culture, and values. That kind of principles. And so it's all about rethinking space, economy, community in a very nationalizing context. So when I try to bring those ideas to mainland China, and when we try to documenting different alternative models, and then we try to organize a conference, the critique immediately come to me is, basically two principles. One is that when I introduce those ideas, those new models, I even invite a scholar from Mount Dragon University, I invite a scholar from Sewa, so all those very sustainable and famous model to challenge the market economy model. But then those students, they're much more progressive than me. So they immediately raised me two queries. The first one is, have you ever tried to connect your talk on social economy to the contemporary crisis of China? Have you ever attempted to do so before you talk about those ideas, those those utopia? So this is the first challenge. The second one is, have you ever attempted to link to the history? We have a long history of socialist revolution. Communist revolution is exactly, the attempt to overthrow the capitalist socialist system. So, and then we fail. So if you don't really connect to the contemporary issue and the historical issue, your talk is meaningless. So This is why I shot myself for a few years. basically, I mean, all those critiques about those social economy ideas, the utopia socialism. And utopian socialism constructs a fantasy about new ideas, new design, new blueprint, but without concrete political economy analysis, without really look into the power, technology, and also class issues. So this is the real, I mean, real challenge. And at worst, they will say that utopian socialism withdraw social forces from class or social struggles and extend as a kind of isolated island in a capitalist world. And then they will say that for sure you can find, I mean, one case here, second case in other places. But all these are isolated cases, and all these are isolated islands. So if you can find some successful models, I can find a thousands of those unsuccessful models to you, Professor Poon. So to me, today, I mean, if we still would like to talk about those platform co-op, whether it would remain another empty slogan, it really depends on whether it is a social movement or whether it is a social revolution embedded within real struggles. So what is real struggles? So she asked me to talk about China. And if those real struggles, that means that we need to have different forces. So what are those historical conditions then, I mean, to really engage in struggle to ask for alternative economy or alternative practices, whatever we name it. So I here trying to let you a little bit know about the context of China and whether those contexts can really provide us different forces to engage in change. This is obvious if we understand China a little bit. So we notice that actually, I mean, China has experienced 30 years of economic transformation, and it had turned itself into a major player in the global capitalist economy. However, China's economic growth has also generated rising problems in inequality, alienation, and problem of sustainability. So the crisis that give rise to experiments in social or solidarity economy are the agrarian crisis of the late 1990s. That's the real problem, the peasants. I mean, you have to understand China is still a peasant society, it's still a working class society, it's not a middle class society. We can easily talk about organic food that. Because in China, when you talk about organic food, I mean, those people will tell you that it's for the middle class consumption, it's never for the working class, it's never for the peasants. So this is, I mean, so we need to root for different kind of driven forces. So these driven forces, I would say, is a kind of agrarian crisis that born in the late 90s with the continuous migration and labor conflict, which is really my areas. So these two major social problems create the driving force for us to look for alternative. So let's look a little bit about agrarian crisis. Agrarian crisis in China means intertwined problems in sustaining rural production, rural community, and rural livelihood. And China's rural reform, I mean, we started in the early 1980s. We almost smashed all collective. I mean, we destroyed the communist system. So we distributed pieces of land to each household. And then after that, every household, every peasant household have to rely on the very small pieces of land in order to survive themselves. So there's a separation between ownership and management of farmland. And since the 90s, rural China has seen a decline, I mean, because of this, I mean, collapse of the collective. So there's a decline in agricultural production, fermentation, and automation of community life, and difficulty in social and cultural reproduction, obviously. So the family-based peasant economy could neither produce or support productivity nor sustain social reproduction. So this is the origin of migration. I mean, this is the origin of more than 280 million migrant population in China every day move here and there looking for jobs in the coastal China, and not only in the coastal China, but today in inland China. So the massive flow of rural migrant workers emerged in since mid-1980s and have expanded ever since, leading China to rise as a welfare tree. But as, I mean, in many of my articles, my argument is that once China become a welfare tree, obviously we will have a formation of a huge working class, if not the largest working class in the world. So in that context, we have a lot of capital labor conflict crisis, not only labor and not only capital and labor conflict, but also labor and state conflicts. So we have minimum forms of conflict created by China as once it turned itself into a welfare tree. So the current issue, I mean, I'm not quite sure whether you really, I mean, notice of the recent struggle, that is the Jet Set workers and students struggle. I don't really have time to mention this struggle, but briefly is simply because I 20 to 30 workers, they would like to set a trade union inside their factory. And this kind of event is, I mean, it's so normal, happening in China every day. But this case makes it so unusual simply because it attract a number of students coming from Beijing, from those major universities, Peking University, Tsinghua University, Renmin University. They all come down to the Shenzhen industrial area to support these workers. So make it as really a scene, I mean, as a case for us to reflect. I mean, the existing mode of development is really toxic. It's really unacceptable to most of the workers, to most of the students, of the students now. So the unity between students and workers now is formed to confirm and also challenge a neoliberal economy that only serves the interests of transnational corporation and the elite classes. And obviously that results in creating all sorts of problems. I mean, everybody here noticed that. So I don't really have to repeat that. And so China is really at the crossroad of the future development. The recent global crisis compelled us in China or elsewhere to re-examine the neoliberal development that has dominated China for several decades. So rethinking the rise of China and also its social and ecology impacts, it is quite imperative for us, I mean, who are critical of capitalist way of development, to ponder on alternative economies and other modernities. So this is the contemporary crisis or the contemporary issue I try to link up with. I mean, why should we look for those alternatives as a kind of attempt to address to the student they put to me? So move from the contemporary aspect, I try my best to link up with the historical struggle, but which is the most difficult part for me, because we all know that, I mean, everybody grew up in Hong Kong, teaching Hong Kong or elsewhere, we are quite unfamiliar with the historical struggle, but that struggle is really part of the China history. So the final part is, I mean, how could we rethink the socialist revolution? I mean, whenever we talk about social economy, co-op, I mean, people, we tell you, we already have the struggle. So what's the relationship between these two? So unlike other capitalist society, China has a history of socialist revolution which has called upon to overthrow capitalist society, capitalist system. So regarding the Chinese Revolution, there's always a simple story that was told every time, repeating, that it was failed and the revolution was a failure. And the failure was first of all caused by an authoritarian party. Second, was as a party, it was an inactive, bureaucratic, and ossified state organ. And there's also stagnancy of economic development, suppression of personal freedom, and also chaotic of cultural revolution, etc. So those are the common factors. I mean, whenever we talk about the revolution, those are factors they try to provide us an account of, I mean, this period of history. And this account, those common factors turn itself to become common sense. So we don't need to, read into the history quite seriously, because we already know it, and it's repeating by both left wing and even those right wing. I mean, right wing, obviously, we repeat this, the story, but even the leftists and the left wing in the Western, they're repeating the same sort of stories. So the common sense is self-explanatory, and there's no more, we can really understand, what happened. So I just want to come back to the very basic. When you think about common, so obviously they have some certain relationship with communist revolution. So let's figure out what is communist revolution. So in manifesto of the Communist Party, Marx and Engels defined enemies of the revolution as the ruling classes represented the interests of the bourgeoisie and the other oppressive classes. The immediate aim of the communists is to do what? Is to do first formation of the proletariat into a class. So this is the first step you have to do, or they have to do, not we. They. And the second is the overthrow of the bourgeoisie supremacy. And the third is the conquest of the political power. Without these three steps to them, or even to today's the youngest people in China, there's no hope, and there's no hope to carry any kind of revolution. And the more specific goal is to abolish the bourgeoisie poverty, because whenever we talk about common, we never talk about poverty. But at the end of the day, it's all about poverty issues. So it's to abolish the bourgeoisie poverty, which is the foundation of building a communist society and the groundwork of all personal freedom, activity, and independence. So in this sense, the theory of the communists may have summed up in a single sentence, is abolition of private poverty. So after reading all this work, I finally understand that why in Beijing I was challenged, because we dare not to talk about abolition of the private poverty. Then we start to talk about commons, So where those commons come from? Who support those commons? Where's the causes? How can we really sustain it if we still let those big companies to still occupy big shares? And as for those who without any kind of resources, the working class, the farmers, to share with each other. So, where's those resources come from? So this is why I'm aware of those debates. But then, how to achieve those communist goals? No matter you agree with them or not. So the answer, the answer to them is they have to go through a communist revolution. The communists openly declare that their ends can be attained not only by forceful overthrow of all existing social conditions. Let the ruling classes tremble at the communist revolution. The proletarians have nothing to lose but their chains. They have a will to win. But then still, there's slogan. Those slogans have to be actualized. So Lenin provide a kind of theory, to how to really carry the communist revolution. So he come up with a theory of dictatorship of proletariat. In China, when I talk to when I really debate with the student, because whenever I heard about the word dictatorship, because I was really grown up in Hong Kong, and I have all my education in Hong Kong and in UK. So the word of dictatorship is impossible for us to accept it. But then when I go for those literature, when I read debate with those students, I realize even though I can't agree with all of them, but I understand why they're using this kind of language. So here it's saying that overthrow the bourgeoisie state led by the vanguard of the working class is the historical necessity for causing a revolution. So to them, the capitalist society is the dictatorship of bourgeoisie. So there's dictatorship of bourgeoisie, I mean, all kinds of those parties, they're the dictatorship form of the bourgeoisie. So if you want to overthrow them, obviously, you need to another form of, I mean, proletarian dictatorship, which means that the Communist Party have to take up those duty or those mission, I mean, to run or to confirm the bourgeoisie dictatorship. But the dictatorship is only the first stage. Lenin talked about the second stage, which is about the dissolution of the party, the dissolution, that means the dismissal. I mean, kick it away. So it's the dissolution of the party and the whittling away of the state. So that means that the final goal through those dictatorship form is to end the state and end the party. But however, we all know that. Unlike the Lenin has said that the state would be whittling away, the party in reality continue to stay and turn itself into a party form and a party state form after the Communist Revolution. So one, I mean, why? What is the justification for the dictatorship of the proletariat? If we look into the classic, in the critique of the Gotham Program, Marx briefly say this. Between capitalist and communist society, there lies the period of the revolution transformation of the one into the other. Corresponding to this is also a political transition period in which the state can be nothing but the revolution dictatorship of the proletariat. So, I mean, in the Gotha program, Marx try to explain why in the transitional period they still need a state. Because we can't really drum immediately from a capitalist world after the revolution immediately to a communist society. So there should be a period of transition, I mean, according to his theory. So, I mean, all sorts of critique obviously came when this political transitional period was unlikely to end. So when the party state finally turned itself to be very bureaucratic, oppressive, the dream of communism was dashed, was end, I mean, was no more. So so this is the usual story. I mean, whenever we try to understand those history. Today, I add a little bit, I mean, on this part of understanding. I try to supplement a kind of class perspective. I tell everybody that when I was young, I was a post-Marxist, I was a post-structuralist. When I was old, I was a Marxist. So it's quite reversed to be sure here. But then why? Why? Simply because those, to me, those ideas, they really have to put into practice. So once you put into practice, you understand all sorts of conditioning really surround you. So when I really get engaged in those labor movement or labor struggles, I understand a little bit about the history and also the contemporary struggles. So without a truly class perspective, we can't hardly understand why the communist revolution failed. So I would like to say in this way that simply because we don't really investigate the enemy of the party through the class lens, and also we did not really try to understand the socialist society after the liberation, after the 1949, through the class perspective. So that distract ourselves from really diagnose those problems. I mean, but this is only my own perspective. So I would say that once class conflict still exists, the revolution is not yet over. So as the party or the party state, because the end of the party state means the end of the class conflict. So if we still have those class conflict, there's no hope that the state will still be there. So if we look at the China Revolution, my argument is simple and direct now. The China's revolution of 1949 is an unfinished one. So 1949 is not the final victory of the communist revolution. Instead, it signals a new beginning of a new era of continuous revolution. A product of socialism in one country that's not going to work. But socialism in one country is a reality. It's surrounded by a strong bourgeoisie state in the new world order. So how could you cancel your own party state? I mean, if you're really surrounded by very strong enemies. So this is, I mean, that means that we are still within the transitional period. So by 1949, when the CCC has achieved was only national unification and the eviction of foreign imperial powers. And the transition to socialism was not yet to come, including the process of withering away of the party state. And yet, it looked like a mission impossible. As promised by Karl Marx's theory, the dictatorship of proletariat or landings within our way of the state thesis, I mean, which is in historical struggle. But then why? I mean, why? So briefly, I mean, I don't have enough time, so we look at two factors. One is international factors, and one is internal factors. International factors I have just mentioned. The communist revolution in the third world and in third world society, they're actually betrayed by the Western leftist movement and become one country socialism. So if we have any hope, that has to be an internationalism. But then proletarian internationalism was betrayed by both Western and Russian communism in the late 19th and 20th centuries. The center of revolution has no choice but shift to the third world countries, which has brought into world capitalism and imperialism by armed forces. So we do it by armed forces. And the Chinese Revolution is by nature a national and socialist revolution, as well as provisional and transitional. So the party state here, is to safeguard the foot of the revolution from the enemies of the Western capitalist world. So the historic conditioning of withering our way, it doesn't exist in China nor in other places. So we move quickly from the international factor to the internal factors. Let us briefly understand the Chinese Revolution after 49 into two periods. I mean, this is textbook knowledge. So the first period is the socialist construction period. I mean, from 1491 to 1957, I mean, we call it economic and material basis transformation. So this transformation is to create a socialist transformation condition by which class contradiction based on private ownership of the means of production could be gradually resolved. That means gradually we transform those private ownership. And move from the first phase, we have the second phase. So resolve those political and resolve those social and economic basis, we move to political and ideological basis. So that's why we have the Cultural Revolution. So the Cultural Revolution is to resolve the political and ideological contradiction inside the party itself. So Mao Zedong called working class, those students, to smash his own party because it become bureaucratic. So this is a very brief history, I mean, brief overview. But then what is usually missing is we didn't really try to figure out what are those internal enemies. I mean, we have international enemies, external enemies, but we never look at our own enemies. So I always say that after 1949, we never really resolve our own class conflict inside the society. So at least we have four new kind of new internal enemies after the revolution. The first type, I mean, is the old civic servants who work in the Kuomintang government, but now they remain and work for the new government. The second type is the intellectual of old type of learning who still prefer a hierarchical society. And also we still have, a number of liberal intellectual who believe in a Western parliamentary democracy. So we still have old civic servants. We don't really support the communist revolution. We still have a different type of intellectual who have doubts, at least have doubts on the revolution. And we also have national bourgeoisie and its supporters. Even after the economic transformation, they still not the real supporter of the revolution. And we have the rich person. I mean, we try to build the collectivization, but there's huge barriers. But not the barrier is not as strong as the Russian revolution, but still we have certain kind of resistance, which is fair. I mean, it's all fair to me. So we still have the rich passions. And I mean, the fifth one is the most significant one. It's the party revisionist who refuse or might not agree with Mao's principle to transform the society. So they don't agree with those radical policy for social change. So before Mao died in 1976, he openly said to everybody, bourgeoisie is now in the party. So the bourgeoisie now in the party is going to transform China after he died. So that's why we have the reform. So that's why we have the today contradictions. So this is all the history we briefly we don't have really enough time here, but just provide you a very brief review. So to me, trying to conclude today's presentation, without a complete revolution or without a continual revolution until it's complete, the power of the bourgeoisie in whatever form will come back. So they can come back to your party, they can come back to your trade union, they can come back to your company, they can come back to everywhere, to the school. So in China, this class power has come back with the historical historical conditioning. So we present it largely as, and simplify it as, conflict between bureaucratic and the mass and in post-socialist society. So today, in socialist period, when those struggle, they should be framed like struggle between ordinary people and the bureaucrats and the bureaucratics. But then we frame it as class struggle. And today, when those struggle actually they already appeal in a class nature, the language we're using is between state and the civil society. So, but to me, all those are class conflict in nature. And the concept of working class is not itself problematic. The problem lies exactly, the problem is because we are still lacking enough forces to challenge the global capital system and part of the organs and part of the state, which are fueled up by the class enemies. But I still have hope, because China become a global center of capital and global center of class conflict. So class forces obviously will come back. The idea of communism was largely vanished, but not the struggle of it. So point of time and at the crossroad of China future development, we can talk about different kind of alternative, different kind of practices. So this is my presentation. Thank you very much.